Shabbat Shalom, everybody. It's Rabbi Stephen here, Rav Shmuel ben Yehoshua, Rashbi in the house. And I want to thank everybody that joined us for my first full weekend with Temple Shalom of Ontario, my new gig, my new venue. And I'm very excited, and I'm looking forward to serving the congregation. And for the rest of you, please join us. Please join us. We're starting to plan for the high holidays, and yeah, it's a little bit of a drive. Up in Ontario, but it should be good. I'm looking forward to it. We'll have a great cantor guest, and I'm looking forward to it. This week, in fact, I usually put this out on Wednesday, and Wednesday evening starts the holiday of, and it's a holy day, Tisha B'Av. It is a rabbinically mandated fast day. It is a holiday. It is almost like Yom Kippur. It's like a Shabbat and a day of mourning, in that we don't do any work, and we're remembering God. This is the day when God decreed that the Israelites will spend the next 39 years in the wilderness after the report of the spies. It's when both temples were destroyed. It was when the Spanish Inquisition started, when Jews were kicked out of Spain. It was also the beginning of World War I, whose economic conditions led to the Holocaust. So it's a very, very somber day. We typically fast. The Book of Lamentations, written by Jeremiah, is read in a very, in a little bit of a different cantillation. And there's also some poems that we read. And I believe there's a, there is a Talmud track that's read on that day. I'm not sure exactly what it is yet. I believe it's either Gittin or Sofa or Sota from either those tractates. And it discusses how these two rabbis were kind of in competition. They invited the Romans in to help settle a dispute, and that was part of the decline of the Second Temple. So come join us. It'll be on Zoom, and let me know if you want. We'll get you the Zoom address. So this week, the second portion of Deuteronomy, the Et Hanan. And there's a lot going on in this portion. Okay, Moses is he's warning them, he's admonishing them. And he's admonishing the Israelites, the new generation, who is going to be led by Yehoshua ben Nun, Joshua, and led by Eleazar, the high priest, into the new land, the promised land, to take the land and now settle it. So Moses starts off by talking about, by admonishing them not to worship, not to get involved in other idols. He's saying, look, when you get in there, clear the land, you know, do battle with the Canaanites and their pagans, their idolaters. And typically, again, idolaters don't have great morals. You know, they worship things, they don't worship the one God, and that, you know, is reflected in their morality. And Moses is telling them, you know, you can't have these people around. They're going to influence you. And as far as the paganry goes, remember, there is the one God. There is Hashem. That's it. And he goes through like a laundry list of what not, of who and what not to worship. He says, don't worship any animals, any cattle, any sheep, any oxen. Don't worship any other type of animals, animals that creep, like lizards or crocodiles or whatever. Don't worship any birds, and don't worship any fish. Don't worship any things, any heavenly bodies. And he just goes through the list. Then there is a review of the Ten Commandments. And the Ten Commandments are just a little bit different in Deuteronomy than they are in Exodus. Why? Well, there's a lot of reasons posited, but one of the big reasons is that with this generation going into the new land, they're going to need to know this. Now, all right, when Deuteronomy, Moses reviews a lot of the laws, adds a few new ones that the Israelites are going to need as they settle in the land. But of course, the big things, he's starting out right with the important things. Don't worship other idols, and here are the Ten Commandments. Now, one of the most prominent differences in this version of the Ten Commandments versus the version we saw in Exodus is the fourth commandment, honor the Shabbat, okay? So in Exodus, it's Zachor, remember. Here in Deuteronomy, it's Shamor, guard or keep. Very important, because back then it was still kind of theoretical. Now, it's more practical. Think about it. These people are going to need to know these things when they go into the land. They're going to need to know that you stay away from the idols, but they're also going to say, honor the Sabbath. Why? What is the Sabbath for? It's to reconnect with your spirituality. It's to worship and thank God for all the goodly blessings that you have. So it's very important, especially with these idolaters, that you not just remember, but now you have to guard it. Now, as you remember, in Lecha Dodi, which is what we sing during the Friday night Kabbalat Shabbat, the Shabbat Ma'ariv, the first verse, Shamor V'Zachor, the Dibur Echa, right? You know, remember and guard. And a lot of the sages will say that when God was giving the commandments to Moses, he said both of those at the same time. Of course, the people's perception wasn't as evolved enough to really be able to determine and have that distinction of, oh, he wants us to remember and guard the Shabbat. But here it's kind of, but in the Torah, in the written Torah, it's divided up. Right? So that's one of the big ones. The next big one is the Shema and the V'ahavta. Lot going on in this portion. I mean, starts out, you know, back in the last portion in Deuteronomy, Devarim, you know, Moses kind of gave a review of where the Israelites have been, and that was kind of euphemisms for the events that happened. Talked about how he's not going to go into the land, Joshua's going to lead everybody in, and now we're starting to get into the thick of things. And after the Ten Commandments, what's the next important thing? It's the Shema. Now, the Shema is at once being acknowledged as our most important prayer. And yet it's not a prayer. It's not in a prayer in a sense that it doesn't have the same formulation that most of our prayers have, either Baruch Atah, you know, blessed be thou, O God, Baruch Atah Adonai, or Baruch Atah Adonai, Eloheinu Melech HaOlam, you know, God of the universe, where you have the longer prayers. And the Shema is just the Shema. It's a passage out of the Torah. I don't mean just, but it's a passage out of the Torah. It's an acknowledgement. So we have the Shema. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. And I don't talk about this probably enough, but in the Torah itself, and in the prayer books, this is replicated, the ayin, the last letter of the three words Shema. You know, you have the Shin, the Mem, and then, let's see if I can make it, the kind of like an, yeah, there we go, kind of an ayin, right? And the ayin is enlarged. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. And the dalet, more like, kind of like this. It's got a little tail at the end to, you know, distinguish it from the resh, right? So the dalet is also enlarged because the ayin and the dalet together spell the word aid, which means witness. And when we say the Shema, we are, in a sense, taking it upon ourselves to witness the covenant, the brit, between Hashem and ourselves. Every Israelite is a witness. So first we have the Ten Commandments. Think about, consider this. We have the Ten Commandments, kind of redo. Little differences, mostly with the fourth one, with the guarding the Shema, guarding the Shabbat. And then we have the Shema, and embedded within the Shema is the idea of witnessing. So in a sense, it's sort of an acknowledgement. Think about the flow of this portion. Ten Commandments and then the Shema. So it's an acknowledgement that we as Israelites, as Jews, as Hebrews, even though we may not have been physically at the Mount Sinai when Moses got the Ten Commandments, we're still witnessing. We witness the Ten Commandments and we hear the Word of God. Hear, Israel, the Lord is one. Hear that first commandment, one God. That's it. I'm the only God there is. I brought you out of Egypt to be your God, right? We are all witnesses of the Ten Commandments, and we're all acknowledging that we're witnesses. We're all acknowledging that we're going to do our best to honor the commandments. We then go into the V'ahavta, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. Now, Baruch Shem Kavod, that middle sentence between the Shema and the V'ahavta, when we're saying, you know, love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might, by, you know, these words shall be upon your heart. It's the commandments individually, that we're individually, each one of us was a witness. and we're acknowledging that we're going to pay, that we're going to honor the commandments. Now, Baruch Shem Kavod is not in the Torah. It's in the Midrash when Jacob was blessing his sons. He thought maybe, you know, down the road there might be someone, you know, who just kind of is evil, has an issue, you know, is not, you know, what God wants us to be. And that was sort of an acknowledgement. The reason it's in there, though, in the daily prayers, it forms a distinction, kind of a line between the Shema, which is a an imperative, you know, Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one, and the declaration that, you know, and you shall love the Lord your God. It's kind of a commandment. See, so that kind of separates it. And we say that, we take a pause, you know, kind of enacting kind of a beat, you know, to acknowledge that. Okay, so that's my Devar Torah for this week, my 10-minute Torah. Hope to see you all Wednesday evening for our presentation for the reading of Lamentations and little discussion about Tisha B'Av. Hope you're having a great week. And hey, we're coming up on the high holidays, only 8 weeks, right? 7 weeks. So Shabbat Shalom.